powerful prayer meeting that's occurring right here, and a lot of things begin to take place. And I don't know about you, I'm just going to be very transparent and honest, that I don't want to be part of a passive church. I don't want to be part of a lukewarm church, and I sure don't want to be part of a cold church. And, you know, that really starts with me, right? It's my passion for Christ. It's about spending time with Him. And so I just want to be, I want to, and I think most of you would agree that we want to be on fire for the Lord Jesus Christ. End of story. And that comes out in our lives as we spend time with Him. But check out this prayer meeting. It's a pretty awesome prayer meeting. Quite nothing like we had Thursday, but it's in Acts 4:31. And you should take a look at it this week. And they, the apostles and the disciples, they were there at a home gathering. Must have been a big house because there was a lot of them there. And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were filled with the Holy Ghost. And they began to speak the word of God with boldness. So God, my prayer is that, Lord, by faith, that you will shake us out of our lethargic, passive coldness toward you, Lord Jesus Christ, and toward those that you bring into our life and to the work that is set before us. Lord, I pray for a shaking today, Lord.
Yep.
I pray, God, that you would shake this ground, Lord God, and it begins with us, God. The Bible says that it begins in the house of God. Judgment begins in the house of God. So, Lord, by faith, maybe all of us should just open our hearts, Lord. Begin with us. Shake us really good, Lord. And let us just have a holy, holy desire and passion for Thee and Thee, Lord. Oh, grant Holy Spirit now. Come. Come, Holy Spirit of God, and envelop our hearts, envelop our minds, and let us do the next thing, Lord, with praise and worship. We thank you, Father, and we commit this whole entire day into your loving hands. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
this morning. He is good, amen. Outside in the grass, And then he looks down and he counts 1, 2, 3. I have 4 children. Where's the 4th? How frantically do you think he would just take off running back into that house to go find that one child that is still there? And think about your heavenly Father, how much he loves you. Won't he go after you if you stray?
Yes.
Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for your amazing, incredible love for us. God, you paid it all for us, Lord. There's nothing that we could ever do to earn your love, God, to earn what you've done for us. All you simply do is ask us to surrender our hearts to you. Right now, we just surrender our hearts to you, Lord. You are so, so good, God.
Tear down, coming out to me.
pursues us. He's just waiting for us to pursue him. Amen. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, that you never give up on us.
Yeah.
St. Augustine said that prepare yourself now for what lies in the future. In the future, in eternity, one thing we will be doing is worshiping God. We will be worshiping God. I don't know how it's going to look like, but it's going to be giving total homage to the Lord. So that is something that we can do now that we as Christians, as believers, will be doing in eternity. So just three housekeeping, and then we have a little presentation to do. We got an upcoming youth conference, so you are all invited. So it's just not for the youth, it's for all of us. I want Eli just to get on that really quick while he's showing off that fancy shirt.
Amen, amen. Check, check, check.
Aren't we glad the mic's working now?
Amen. Yeah.
We spent so many years on this. Yes, this shirt right here, it's May 4th, upcoming youth conference, our first youth conference of our church this year. You guys are all invited. Bring your kids, bring your kids' friends, bring anyone. We're really just going to try to really just sit on the youth and those to come, because that's really important, right? This next generation to come. And be one of those people that, you know, that say, you know, man, this generation's messed up. You should be one of those people that are inviting the youth in, right? It's the difference that we can try to make in our lives. Amen?
Also, I tend to forget, so I brought this up because we're going to take communion next Sunday. We'll take communion, and we've got to do this Thursday. So this coming Sunday, we're going to take communion, and I hope you can join us and prepare your heart as we remember our Lord Jesus Christ in our presence. Communion is just simply remembering our unseen guest, and his name is Jesus, and we commit to following him. We are forgiven through his blood, and so we just, he says to do this in remembrance of me as often as you remember. So I remembered recently that it's time to take communion as a church family. Bart, what are a few other announcements before I get ahead of you?
So I want to remind you guys that we have an agape box and a prayer request box back there. So if there's anything on your heart that you need prayer for, please feel free to put that in there. The church does pray for you. We're going to have a potluck after service.
Yes!
We're going to have a potluck next Sunday, too. We're going to have some celebrations for birthdays and stuff like that. So please come and enjoy the food and bring something if you can. And then also, I think we're looking for volunteers for the youth conference coming up on May 4th. So if anyone's interested in doing that, please let Pastor Banks know.
Spark's birthday next week. Are you shooting Eli and Mark can use all the help that they can get for the upcoming youth conference, May 4th and 5th, by the way. All right, so if I can get the DeLisa family to come up front, and then we'll do a quick pause so y'all can greet each other, and there's some people that you have not seen here before, trust me. The DeLisa family come up front. I got Phil Vanderkratz, and I got Barb up there. So, you know, praise the Lord, Jose. I'm glad Jose came front and center today. See, it's nice for bringing home, Jose, front and center. Hey, is hard work. I think we would all agree with that. Ministry, church, what's asked of you, it takes a lot of commitment, and it takes a lot of sacrifice on your family and tweaking your schedule. So we wanted to simply show appreciation for them from Freedom. I know Phil Vanderkratz got one a few months ago, and some of you are going to be getting these here in the next few weeks and next coming 3 weeks, but Dustin and Jennifer, we so appreciate your hard work with us. God dropped you in on us 3 or 4 years ago, and I'm honestly surprised you guys are still here with us. But,
hey, thanks everybody. Ministry is hard, but it's easy when Jesus died for you, and you realize that. We don't work towards our salvation. We work from our salvation. And these things are awesome because it's a reminder. It's a breath of fresh air. It's a nice cold glass of water. But without this, It's all because of Jesus that we have a servant's heart. And so that's the bottom line. And then on top of that, we're here because God ordained it. We were going to come out here, and He set the path towards this ministry before we even left. And when we got here, we realized our family's here. So just like thank you for coming so much. Sometimes there's things that you do because they're your family, right? And honestly, it's been a long time since we decided to choose a church. God has always chosen churches for us. And this time, He picked a really good one. So I appreciate that. I appreciate everything you all do. I appreciate your sacrifice because it helps us to remember to sacrifice for one another, too. Yeah.
Take a quick 3-minute pause, greet one another, greet each other with not a holy kiss, a holy handshake. And say hi to somebody. Get Phil's going.
Movie night.
Movie night. May 10th. Fall on a Friday. May 10th. Question before I go right into some testimony time. Who was not, I know he wasn't here, let's give him one of these. Who was not here Thursday at our home family retreat? Who was not there Thursday? You got one. I need some help here. Who can help me pass this out? Who was not, Christina, you're
here. Where's Joe?
Yeah, he went to Lily over there. Who else was not with us on Thursday?
He likes to do the altar call early sometimes. He likes to get us there. He's like, I need my blessing now.
McCreary, Chiefhead, get one of the elders. Elvis, Elder Jason, not here. All right, let's get one to Elder Phil. Elder Phil is here, so we'll get one to him and Rita. So you might be wondering what am I giving out? It's not top secret. None of this is top secret, by the way. It's just simply the vision that we are incorporating, and we're letting you all know of the vision. So this is pretty much dial you in on what we're up to as a church leadership body, and we want you to incorporate it and run with us in 2024. So, there's some special guest, Jerry McCreary's here. I met Jerry yesterday, but he actually has known Elena for 30, 40 years. She knew Vincent Garcia, so just raise your hand. Jerry, if you would.
You're welcome.
I'll get it down as I get to you. It takes me a while. So we have a few testimonies. I think Manuel has one. So Manuel, you want to come on up here? And if you have a testimony, I think Eli said, hey, I got a testimony. And so come on up here, or you're gonna lose your opportunity, brother. So you should, who else has a testimony? All right, man. No, they look like a pretty mean bunch, but trust me, they're really easy to get along with. So use the mic.
Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Put it right up to your mouth.
Okay, good morning, everyone. This is Manuel. I'm Emilio. No, this is not General Douglas MacArthur. Side note. I want to share a scripture with everybody. It says, it's in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3 to 5. It says, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man in war than himself entangle himself with the affairs of his life, that he may please him who has chosen to be a soldier. And if a man also strive for masteries, yet he is not crowned except he strive lawfully. So in other words, as Christians, we are in God's army. We're on the winning side. And when we're in the winning side, we know that God can do anything for us. We just have to put him first. And so in other words, we've got to just be there for God, and he'll be there for us. And I wanted to also share about the Wednesday night men's Bible studies, you know. And they've been going really good, the men's Bible studies. Been learning a lot, getting new people that are starting to show up, a few new guys. And and they're asking questions. What does this mean? What does that mean? And no, we're not going to just throw a book of Revelation like that at them. You know, we're going to just start with the basics, like, I believe it's the Gospel of Luke and John, you know, basic stuff. But yes, the church is growing. And also, me personally, just seeing my niece going to church, you know, to another church, South Bay, the Crossroads, and that's good. So that's a blessing, actually, to live a life to God, to get baptized. My brother-in-law would say, my sister, they rededicated themselves, and I was trying to go back to church, and we've been pulled away from it for now. So that's the beginning. So I'm just telling you, don't give up on your family members, because they will eventually, they will come to God. Also, I have a friend of mine, his name is Julian. He works on the target, and he asks me questions, you know what? He goes, what is the Bible? What does this mean? What does that mean? Oh, I haven't gone to church in a long time. I know I need to go back, pray for me. And I'm like, God, my God just moved me, you know? And so I started talking to him and sending him scriptures and texting him, you know, Bible messages. And so it's a blessing. So me personally, in my life, God is moving, because I know that, you know, you have to make sacrifices, God. If you want to draw close to God, you have to just, you know, just draw everything out. Go in a study room or somewhere where you just pray and read the Bible and just block everything else. And that's how you draw closer to God. It's not easy, but God will help us do it.
You're doing it. Good job. Anyone else? Testimony is simply bragging on God. So if you hear the word testimony, just simply bragging on God and everything He's doing. And so you'll get opportunity to brag on God too.
Amen, amen. So I'm trying to explain this testimony as best as I can. But pretty much, I had these important business checks that I was going to cash in for myself. And I was going home with them, and it was really windy that day. So you can already guess what happened. So I was coming up my stairs, and I had my dog, and she was barking. I don't know why she didn't remember it was me. She started barking. I'm like, be quiet, quit barking at me. So then, as I told her to be quiet, all the checks that I had that I was going to cash in the next day, it just fell everywhere because the wind was just blowing hard. So I was able to save four. And then the fifth one, it just went downstairs somewhere and I don't even know where it went, right? So I was like, oh my goodness. And worst case scenario, you know, the guy that gave it to me would destroy it again, of course. But I didn't want to have to go through all that. And so I lost the check, right? And I look and I go downstairs and I'm like, God, where is it? And I'm like, God, just, you know, in that desperate, just being in that desperate moment and like just really being desperate, honestly, like, God, that's never happened to me before. And so I'm looking, I'm praying, I'm like, God, show me where it is. And I just hear Him tell me in my thoughts and just go back. So I was looking in front of my where the parking lot is. But then as I pray, I'm like, God, show me where it is. He tells me to go back. Right? So go back to kind of like where the stairs are behind me. So go back. So then I go back, but I don't see nothing. So I'm like, what do you mean go back? There's nothing there, right? But then my little brother comes out and sees me all worried. He's like, what are you worried about? What's wrong? And I'm like, I lost the checks. And I was getting mad. I was getting really mad, actually. And he goes and says, why don't you look over there in the area? It's not over there. Your shirt's not over there. And that's where God had told me to go back to. So then I go downstairs, right? See, God is so good. He's using my little brother already. So then I go back downstairs in the area he told me to check. And it was right there. On the floor. And looking back and praying about that testimony is that, like, it, what really hit my heart about it is that, first of all, it was so windy that day. And the fact that the check just got caught in a little dirt right there, like, perfectly just caught right there, like, that was just amazing in itself. But then the second part was that I also seen is that that brotherly love between me and my little brother. You know, him wanting to help me out, be there for me. Go, oh, I'm over there, I'll come help you find you here, go check over here. And really that just shows me how God is working in his life, in my life, in all our lives, and just seeing that brotherly love and that's what happened to one another. We want to help one another, encourage one another, build one another up. That's what I had got about that testimony. I love that I lost the check now. See, because it encouraged me.
Simply, again, testimony, just simply bragging on what God is doing in your life.
I just wanted to share this real quick for members that are new that haven't heard my testimony of a story way back when I used to be a personal trainer and then I ended up working for a physical therapist in the convalescent home. Long story short, I walk in early in the morning and the nurse comes up to me and says that a bishop from the Catholic Church wanted to see me. I don't want to work with him until the evening. And I go, what's up? She goes, he's dying. Hit me. Wow, this guy? He was such a great guy. And I'm not Catholic, but the guy was still filled with good spirit, you know, like you all were. So, man, I'm going to tell this guy, I don't know what to do. So I walk in his room, and he's smiling at me. He goes, hey, Brother Wagner, how you doing? I wasn't expecting that. How am I doing? Fine, I'm not going to tell him. And we start talking about other things, try to make it short. But anyway, he starts talking about other things, and he goes, Brother Wagner, with a smile on his face, I'll never forget this, I love sharing it. I guess he figured I had a big mouth, I'd tell people I'm not afraid, whatever. I can't talk for beans, but anyway. He goes, Brother Wagner, do you hear the music? I'm not going to tell you about the music. But I knew his spirit and where he was going. And of course I said, yeah, I heard the music just to comfort him. And he passes away. So there you go.
Praise God.
Spelling out how the galaxies are layered upon galaxies, and I mean, he's throwing numbers and things out there that my brain, I can't follow along, but because I want to challenge myself sometimes, I listen to people that are a lot brighter than me, and this guy was bright, and so about 15 minutes, I get what he's saying, but here's what he said at the back end before I shut him off, and I would great, godly, the guy knew who he was talking about, creation. But he said that redemption lies within creation. That all throughout the universe, that the Lord is pointing toward redemption that is found in Jesus Christ. But he made that statement that within creation, and it's even in Scripture in the book of Romans, is that that creation itself reveals that there is a creator, so that man is without excuse. So God is waving his hands toward people as they pass through him every day. They're passing through and God is like right there. And if they turn and they look to him, 100% they will find him, because he is a God who wants to disclose himself. He does want to reveal himself to us in a very, very personal way. This is case in point with Mr. Wagner. Maybe he needed to hear that. From a dying priest or a dying bishop. So the Lord has many mysterious ways of getting our attention. And just letting you know, God is searching after you. God is looking for you. And never give up on those lost members in your family. Ephesians chapter 2 is where I'm at, being united for Christ, being united for Christ. I'll begin at verse number 1. And in regards to being united in Christ, is we want to be united with those that are serving the Lord, that are obviously in the context of what I believe of any local church. You want to be united. You don't want to be united with the world, because if you get united with the world, they're going to begin to dictate your schedule and your priorities. But if you get united and yoked with Christ and a few of his members, you're going to be stronger and stronger and stronger as you find unity. And Jesus spoke about being one, being unified. I believe in the Gospel of John 16 and 17. He talks about being one as I and the Father are one. So that this brings great glory to us that you are united in me. So it brings great glory to God when a church family is all in one accord. They are all in one mind, in one accord. And again, that's why we put out those little notes, because we want you to know what we're up to. Along with, we want to be a church that is in prayer, because as you read, or as I shared from Acts 4:31, they had a prayer moment and things begin to shake. And sometimes we need times like that where we need to spend time with God. So, verse number 1, Paul is the speaker here, and he goes like this. The capstone is made alive in Christ. Made alive in Christ. Paul, once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. I'm going to read that again. I'm going to take my time here. We're doing really good on time for our potluck, so we're ahead of schedule. Praise God. Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. Remember the story of Samson last Sunday. What happened to Samson? The more he played with sin, the more he lost. The more you play with sin and sinful activity, I guarantee you are going to lose. But the more Samson obeyed God, he got to experience God. That's called obedience. That's just called simple obedience. Obedience. And as you obey God, you will do well. You'll be alive in the Spirit because you're obeying the Spirit of God as he leads you. So, disobedience brings about death. You used to live in sin. None of us came out of our womb as Christians. None of us came out of our wombs, out of our mother's wombs, as Christian. You used to live in sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commanders of the powers of the unseen world. I want to stop there. There's a lot of things going on in each one of our lives. A lot of things that are going on in each one of our lives that are pulling us in different directions. The direction that you want to be pulled toward in your journey is how God wants to lead you. Paul says, for many years are led by the Spirit. They're the sons and daughters of God. So one thing that we want to be pulled into is following, doing the will of God in our lives. A gentleman that's here right now, he asked me, how did you even find this convalescent, this home? There was a home there in Monterey that we've been, me and Brother Manuel have been ministering to. He asked me, how did you find this place anyways? And that was a really good question. How did I end up in this convalescent home sharing with some elderly, homebound people? And I said, well, yeah, I remember how I met this place. Brother, the Wagners, invited me to meet one of the patients in there that couldn't get out. And I went, and me and Manuel brought him some goodies, some food, some wheat germ, and things that he could take in. And after a few weeks, he kind of dozed off. He was kind of like, I can see that he was not responding to some of our sharing. But what happened before I left the property, the lady in charge, the staff, and even the owner had welcomed us to come back and to do a Bible study with everybody within all the levels there. Everyone's there on the level. And it became one thing after another. And honestly, it's like the second church service for me and Daniel. Isn't it? Where is he at? Isn't it looking like, feels like a church service, brother? It does feel like a church service, brother. Brother Sherman right here. You'll get to listen to him during the potluck. He'll do some great ambiance to just welcome a heavenly atmosphere. Is that what she's saying?
Right on God.
And you know, see, that's what happens when you commit your children, your babies to the Lord. We committed that little girl 6 months ago.
Start them young.
They will not depart. So she's off to Grace Garlamo. There's another few little girls. I don't know if they're here. They're in class. They're doing quite well. We'll see these children. So I'm in Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 2.5. He is the Spirit at work in all those who refuse to do what is right. Verse number 3. All of us are guilty of this. All of us. You and I were guilty of this, that we used to live like that, following the passionate desires and the inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger, just like everyone. But God, who is so rich in mercy, praise God. God is so rich in mercy, and He loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, He gave us life when He raised Christ from the dead. So I'm going to pause right there. I had given out a handout a few times the last few years. I just call it like a little wheel. It's like a little wheel, and they hit on different compartments that you and that I should be working on, not just once a month, not quarterly, but throughout the week. And there was pretty much 5 things I gave them out. One, we ought to spend time with the Lord. We ought to be evangelizing. We ought to be time in the Scriptures. But there's another part in there as we want to grow in our faith, and that is worship. That's worship. Earlier, that's a little bit of an aspect of worship. But genuine worship is a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle of everything you do it as unto Christ. A man by the name of Brother Lawrence, he wasn't a musician. I don't think he ever sang in front of everybody, but he was a simple monk who worked in a monastery. He would prepare omelets and breakfast and grub for all the little monks that joined him in his little monastery. His name was Brother Lawrence. There was a book called Practicing the Presence of God, and he wrote it. But he said, even as he, I love this, because this is like the simplest things that you and I can do. Simple things that you and I can do to show adoration and worship to God. But as he would make omelets for the little priests, for the little monks, he did that as unto the Lord. As he got the dishes done, he did that as unto the Lord. What we do in even the minimum things, if we do it as unto the Lord, it's not so hard. It's not so difficult. Amen? Phil Vandercraft, he gets up Sunday morning. He sings to the Lord. That's not a difficult thing for Phil. He's been doing that for years. He can go around the room, but we all have something. If it becomes a task, maybe we should check our love thermostat. Is it unto the Lord? Is it unto the Lord? Reading on. For he, verse number 6, for he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms, because we are united with Christ. So if you're united with Christ, you are now seated in heavenly places. I would encourage you to access headquarters. Access headquarters, because headquarters is always open for business. Me and my old roommate, we used to work at Boeing back in Phoenix. We used to kid each other. We had a little song, we teased each other. I brought the song up to this day. He doesn't let me live it down. Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. I just messed up that song. But some of you know that stanza. Jesus is on the main line. Tell him what you need. Tell him what you want, because there is no block on that line. There is no block on that line. God wants to hear from you. So God can point to us. Verse 7. So God can point to us and all future ages as examples of an incredible wealth of His grace and kindness toward us, as shown in all that He's done for us who have been united with Jesus Christ. Incredible wealth and grace has been accounted, deposited into our nature. The nature that has taken on Christ. Not to bore you with more stories, but the story where I was in this place and there was little golden specks running around all throughout the water, and I was blown away. It looked like little golden sand that were just floating around. And sure enough, I found out that they were golden sand specks that I was dipping in. And it hit me later that night that that's what God has inside of us. We have wealth. May not be richly tangible worldly wealth, but we have riches in Christ. Just the fact that we can come directly to heaven. You do not need a middleman. You don't need a priest. You don't need the church secretary. You don't need a pastor. You can go directly to God. That is a privilege. That's a wealthy place to be at and see what God will do in and through you. Ask big of God. I want to encourage you. This could be a word for one person here. Ask big from God. The psalmist said, I opened up my mouth wide. He opened it wide and he presented big things, grander things to the Lord. I want to encourage you to go big with God this coming year. God saved you. Praise the Lord. We're all saved. I hope we're all saved. If you're not saved, I want to invite you to come up front as we end our time, and we'll get you up. Jesus is in the house, so He'll save you. And that's right on point. See that? The line is going.
Jesus on the main line.
We're on point today. And she had to answer that call. All right. God saved you. Praise the Lord. God saved you by His grace when you believe, and you can't take credit for this, for it's a gift of God. Verse number 9, salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. So, there's never really no super member church guy, person. There's no superman. If they're doing it for the Lord, praise God. And God is doing something in that individual, praise the Lord. But does it make them like a spiritual leap, like He's all that greater than us? We are all in the same place. We're all on the same level field, but expressing it through different ways. For we are, verse number 10, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us afresh. I like the word afresh in Christ. So we can do the things that He has planned for us long ago to do. I'm going to stop right here. God has prepared good works for you to do. God has your name on certain things that only you can do those things. Only you. And God has ordained you in Christ before the foundations of time. That's why I love sovereignty. The sovereignty of God. Because God has already had a thing, a work, a labor, a task for you to do. Now I want to also say on top of that, you will never be totally fulfilled unless you are doing that thing that God has called you to do. Again, I'll pick on my brother Phil Vandercraft. When he leads worship, I don't think there's any greater place that he'd rather be than leading worship time. He is fully alive. A guy by the name of Eric Liddell, they wrote a movie about him, The Chariots of Fire. A guy named Eric Liddell, he was an Olympic sprinter. And one of the quotes that he has is that, I never feel so fully alive to God than what I'm doing, when He has made me to do. Eric Liddell, I love that quote, because he's running, he's sprinting, and he feels so alive, because that's what God called him to do. Now, that's definitely not what I want to be doing. I don't want to be running on track. But hey, praise the Lord. That makes you feel alive. If you give glory to God and God gives him an opportunity and a platform to share about his faith in Jesus, which he was masterful. In fact, later on in his life, he would end up becoming a missionary. Chariots of Fire, great movie. All right, oneness in Christ. Oneness in Christ. So by faith, we're a group.
this fellowship, we are one in Christ. Don't forget that you Gentiles used to be the outsiders. You hear the word Gentile, just simply means somebody who's not Jewish. They're not Jews, they're Gentiles. Back in the Old Testament, the Jews would consider Gentiles as dogs. Consider them as dogs. They just give them the scraps, the leftovers. You know that in Christ, and we're going to get to this soon, I'm jumping ahead, but what the heck. Christ has baptized us in, so we are no longer dogs. Praise God. That's why we've got to brag about this Jesus Christ, of all that he's done for us. He's worth bragging about. Every waking breath that he gives you. Don't forget that you Gentiles used to be dogs. You were called uncircumcised heathens by the Jews who were proud of their circumcision, even though it affected only their bodies and not their hearts. Ooh, religion. Religion. It hits the outer, the veneer hits the outer man, but it don't penetrate the heart. It doesn't do nothing here. There's no change. You were excluded. In those days you were living apart from Christ, you were excluded from citizenship amongst the people of Israel, and you did not know the covenant promises that God had made to them. The Old Testament, God made many, many, many wonderful promises to the Jew, to the Israelites in the Old Testament. You lived in the world without God and without hope. Verse number 13. But now you have been united with Christ Jesus. Jose, come on up here. Jose, bring Jose up here. Bring Jose up here. Jose, God, Jose. Don't worry, I ain't gonna pick on him. I baptized him. I love him. Come, bring him up this way. But now you have been united with Jose. Once you were far away from God, but now you have been brought near to the blood of Jesus. Case in point, Brother Jose here. Jose. You know, Jose, I love Brother Jose. Not just because he comes to our church, but because he really digs our church. But here's the deal. He is just as united with Christ and for Christ as I am. Though he's not up here preaching, he's shouting down the roof, but he is just as in with God as I am. Isn't that awesome? That God has made Jose part of the family. He made him part of the family. That means that Jose has been excluded from the family of God. From the least of us to the greats of us, in our own thinking perhaps, to the very babies, to the children, we all have been brought in. Thank you, cities. Thank you, Jose. Thank you for being here. He's ready. Okay, so we're all in now. But now you have united with Christ. Once you were far away, but now you have brought through the blood of Jesus Christ. Verse 14, amen. For Christ himself has brought peace to us. If any of you are lacking peace, it's not on the Lord's end. It's on your end. And sometimes where we lose peace is that we jump ahead of God, but we're not where God would have us, where there's unrest, no peace. One of the hallmarks of being in the center of God's will, of doing God's task, is peace. Shalom. It is so beautiful place to be, and I want, church family, I want to spend more time in that place where I'm just in the peace of God. We can all be there. We can all get there. It will take some discipline, though. It will take some discipline, but we can all get there. But we're all experiencing this. He broke down, for Christ has brought peace, he united the Jews and the Gentiles into one people in his own body on the cross. He broke down the wall of hostility that separated us. Church, there should be no hostility, there should be no hostility within the household of God. It does not bring glory to God to have any sort of hostility toward one another. It's for all of us. He broke down the wall of hostility. He did this by ending, so glad that he ended that system of the law, or we'd all be toast. He did this by ending the system of law with his commandments and regulations. He made peace between Jews and Gentiles. Gentiles, and creating in himself one new person. Together, one body, Christ, Christ. Notice anything about the epistles of Paul. It's a constant theme. Christ, Christ reconciled both groups to God by means of his death on the cross, and our hostility toward each other was put to death. If there's any hostility toward one another, which I know there isn't, but if there was, we want to put that thing to rest before the day's out. Even within our family, even in our marriages, even in our friendship, no hostility, no hostility. He brought the good news of peace. Now speaking of Jesus, Jesus, the barrier of peace, he brought the good news of peace to you who were far away from him, and peace to the Jews who were near. Now all of us, I love the way it ends here, now all of us can come. Now all of us can come to the Father through the Spirit because of what Christ has done. Stop. God has already done it all. God has done it all. We just got to step into it. Just got to step into it because God has done it all through Christ, his Son. So we just stay in Christ. It's just like, I've used this illustration, just sitting down. I had a chair here. I just sit down. And that's where we want to, in faith, that's where we want to be at. That's where we want to just be seated in Christ. We don't have to do too much. Guilty of probably trying to do way too much. But sometimes we just got to sit there in Christ. That's where we're at. In Christ. We just sit. Whatever God wants to do, he'll play things out in our lives and inside of us as well. It will show us things that we need to work on. So now you, Gentiles, are no longer strangers. You are now citizens along with God's holy people. You are members of God's family. Let's say that word together. Say that word, family. You know what they used to do in the early church? This is kind of why we do potluck. We're going to do communion next Sunday, but really what communion is really all about is more like how we're doing the potluck. In New Testament practice, that's the way communion really looked like. It was like they called it a big love feast. And everybody brought something, they baked their goods, and maybe who knows, brought some good wine. I don't know. The good stuff though, the pure. They didn't go to the 99-cent store and pick up $1 cookies. They brought the good stuff. No, listen, they brought the good stuff. They brought their best. And man, that's why when we have opportunity, let's bring our best to God. Let's not give them our spare. Here you go, God. We'll bring some tortillas that have been left over in the refrigerator for the last 2 years. Take them out and serve them up. No, we give our best, but I'm saying that a family, you give your best in your family, but in regards to the communion, that's what it would have looked like, is they were having a love feast. Today, the communion, as we know it, if anything, is just a reminder that who's in the house, and who should we be giving thought to as we gather together. Together, we are his house, built on the foundations of the apostles and the prophets. And the cornerstone is Jesus Christ himself. We are carefully joined together at the hip, use that word, at the hip with him, becoming a holy place for the Lord's habitation. Through him, you Gentiles are also being made part of the holy habitations of the Lord by his Spirit. A holy place, a holy family. Let us never forget that our God is holy. Hebrew, the writer, we can just go ahead and and stand right now as we close. We should never lose the fact that our God is a holy God. The Hebrew writer says that without holiness, no man will see God. Now that doesn't mean that you get to just go, you can't just make yourself holy. First of all, when you came to Christ, now you've been set apart, that makes you holy. And then there's this word called sanctification as you're walking for the Lord. That's called sanctification. The Spirit now is working on you, working you over, the Word of God. But just in regards to the word holy, you can't make yourself a holy individual. I can't make myself holy. God makes us holy. We're holy adoption. We're whole, and we represent him. He's our senior shepherd, but he's also the family of the, he's the father of the house here. So we, the way we express him should be, there should be the aspect of holiness, because our God is holy. And in fact, I want to end on a strong note. I said this about the early church, that some people would not even dare come be near them because they knew that God was the centerpiece of their fellowship. So the early church, they weren't after, they got the crowds because they would preach to the crowds. The early church preachers, they were out preaching to the crowds. But when they were in the midst of fellowship, they weren't after the crowds. And again, it says that some people would join themselves to them because they knew that God was in their midst. Wouldn't that be great to be part of a church family where God is there? God is here. This is a reality for all of us. This is real, amen? Now, I think we have a song that our brother wanted us to do. Tell me if I totally dropped the ball. Philip wanted us to do a song. Is that correct? We're supposed to do a song. A song for everyone to come and be part of. I thought we were going to do a song, but praise the Lord. I want to invite you right now, in faith.
best foot forward. He came, something spoke to him. And I just pray, God, for you just to continue to reveal your will. Definitely your will was for him to come to Christ, your son. That is the will of God. But we also pray, God, that you would just unwrap his journey with me, God. And also believe, Lord, that you know that here is a group of people that will love on him, take him where he's at, and just usher him. Lord, just do what only you can do. We love you so much, God. We thank you for this young man's decision today. And you get all the glory and all the honor of you and our upcoming potluck this afternoon, Lord. Get all the glory, all the honor. For in Christ's name, we pray. Yeah. Next to you, hey, there's a potluck, so no